I've just finished donning my overcoat, wool scarf, and three other layers I'll be wearing trekking around outside. I'm on the highest, driest, windiest, and coldest continent on Earth. That's right, it's Brian with you for the last time as we make our way through Antarctica today. And by the looks of it, you might want to put on something a little warmer for this one. I hope you can find your PDF and have it handy while you can still feel your fingers. We're gonna need it as we journey through the icy terrain. With that in mind, our objectives for today are to understand the unique land and climate of Antarctica and describe the role Antarctica plays in the global climate. Antarctica was the last continent to be discovered and explored, first sighted by Russian, British, and American sailors all in the 1820s. The Ross Ice Shelf was explored by the 1840s, but harsh conditions on the continent prevented thorough exploration until 1895. Roald Amundsen of Norway and Robert Scott from Britain both reached the South Pole between 1911 and 1912, but Scott and his team did not survive the return trip. If you're interested in the exciting exploration of Antarctica, read more about the 1914 to 1917 Imperial Trans-Antarctic Expedition. Ernest Shackleton and his crew aboard the Endurance lived through one of the greatest survival stories in modern history. By the 1920s, people were able to explore the continent by airplane, and now they use drones and satellites. It's like they took the sport out of it. Scientists have discovered that Antarctica is the fifth largest continent, smaller than South America, but larger than Europe and Australia. It is located at the very southern tip of the world, surrounding the South Pole. And unlike the ice cap in the north, it sits atop a large amount of land, over 10% of Earth's landmass, in fact. The ice cap climate is the driest on Earth, receiving less than 2 inches of precipitation per year, technically making it a desert, drier even than the Sahara in North Africa or the Taklamakan in East Asia. It is also the highest continent, with an average elevation of 1.3 miles, compared to the rest of the world's 0.6 miles above sea level. Because it's so high up and so cold, the ice never melts. So that 2 inches of snow sits atop last year's 2 inches, and the year before's 2 inches, and so forth. When the pressure builds up, compressing the snow, it becomes a massive ice sheet. These ice sheets have been growing for hundreds of thousands of years and now range from 5,600 to 7,200 feet thick. Even the thinnest ones are more than a mile thick. For now. What do you think happens to the global sea level each year as 2 inches of water across a 5.4 million square mile surface is trapped outside of the oceanic water cycle? That's right, the ice sheets get thicker and the sea level drops. Not by 2 inches, the ocean has a much larger surface area, on the order of 139 million square miles of ice. The incredible weight of the ice sheets puts so much pressure on the land that it pushes it below sea level by as much as 260 feet. This actually makes the Earth somewhat elliptical. If and when the ice returns to the ocean, sea level rise will occur. Keep this sea level rise thought in your mind. The lowest temperature ever officially recorded anywhere on Earth is negative 128.6 degrees Fahrenheit at the Soviet Vostok station in 1983. Unofficial temperatures as low as negative 144 Fahrenheit have been recorded high up in Antarctica's mountains. But the average yearly temperature is a balmy negative 76 Fahrenheit, and that number has been rising in recent decades. The ice affects the Antarctic climate and weather patterns throughout the southern hemisphere. It reflects the sun's rays back into space, rather than absorbing heat, one of the reasons it's so cold there. warmer, slightly wetter conditions near the coasts and the transantarctic mountains allow glaciers to flow over land. They slowly creep from mountains and ice sheet edges to the coast. The average glacier moves between 360 and 3,600 feet in a year. Most of the rest of the land is mountainous, so the glaciers provide the best path for reaching the interior of the continent. Hang on, what dangers do you think are posed by traveling atop a moving glacier? Because they are moving and often get crevasses or large cracks, which can form at any time, they can be dangerous to traverse. The faster, easier way has its risks. Antarctica also has ice shelves, where creeping ice extends out over the ocean and forms permanent extensions. Some shelves cover huge areas of the Ross and Weddell Seas. Ice on shelves can be more than 6,000 feet thick and thin out as they extend further into the ocean away from the pole. The thin parts become brittle, break off, and melt back into warmer waters. In 2002, over a 35-day period, the Larsen B ice shelf, covering more than 1,250 square miles of surface ice, collapsed and broke up into thousands of icebergs, or floating pieces of ice, in the Weddell Sea. Think back for a second. How do you think sea level was affected when the ice from the Larsen B ice shelf fell into the sea? You might think that this ice falling into the sea would cause sea level to rise, but since Larsen B was an ice shelf and not an ice sheet, there was no effect on sea level at all. But climate scientists often point to rising global temperatures as a threat to Antarctic ice sheets, citing a potential risk for a catastrophic 11 feet of sea level rise in the coming century. Pack ice is floating ice driven together into a continuous mass and encircles the continent. It can extend more than 1,000 miles from land during the winter, 10 times larger than it typically is during the summer. This area is a convergence zone where colder Antarctic waters meet warmer Atlantic, Pacific, and Indian Ocean waters. The temperature convergence affects air pressure systems and causes intense storms along Antarctica's coasts. Few plants and animals can survive in these extreme conditions. But contrast in temperatures mixes different layers of water along the edge of pack ice. Nutrient-rich waters rise to the surface, allowing krill to thrive. This brings whales and fish, which feed on the krill. The fish become food for seals, penguins, and other animals. Although no one lives permanently in Antarctica, it does have a seasonal population of between 1,000 and 5,000 people, depending on the year and what science operations have been funded. 11 babies have been born in Antarctica, intentionally. In the 1970s and 80s, Argentina and Chile sent pregnant mothers there in the summer to try and bolster territorial claims. Don't worry, the babies were all safe and made it back to South America, making Antarctica the continent with the lowest infant mortality rate, 0%. In the late 1880s, many nations agreed that Antarctic land had to be permanently occupied and actively governed for a national claim to be valid, and this has never come to pass. In the 20th century, Argentina, Australia, Chile, France, New Zealand, Norway, and the United Kingdom all claimed pie-shaped wedges of land, meeting at the South Pole. These nations did this for a number of reasons, including national pride and the wealth of scientific information to be discovered, but mainly to claim ownership of resources yet to be discovered. Coal has been found, but at this point it is too expensive to mine and transport to be profitable. Recent geological discoveries also suggest a presence of oil, gold, iron, and other minerals. The United States and the USSR, the only world superpowers throughout most of the 20th century, did not make any land claims and still refuse to acknowledge any other land claims. In 1961, 12 countries, including the U.S., ratified an Antarctic Treaty, with many more signing on later. It protects peaceful use of the land, sharing scientific research, and it bans military activity, nuclear explosions, and disposal of radioactive waste. Later amendments have been added to protect wildlife. This makes it the world's largest land reserve. Time for our final critical thinking question in the lesson guide. How do you think the treaty paved the way for future cooperation in exploration? If you said that space exploration still follows this model for the time being, you're pretty smart. No country owns the moon or Mars. Space is peacefully explored and scientists share equipment and data. But corporations might have some different ideas in store for the future. Today, there are 70 permanent research stations representing 29 countries. There is a huge amount of data gathering. One team extracted a core sample suggesting that the ice was formed over 450,000 years ago, as its layers give clues about environmental conditions over time. There is also an ongoing search for microscopic life forms in lakes deep in the bedrock. These crevices have been sealed for millennia beneath the ice. It's a potential gold mine for data about past life on Earth. Just when you thought you'd seen it all, we had a whole new continent hidden up our sleeve, saved for last. And believe it or not, this complex, diverse, flawed, beautiful, surprising, wondrous Earth of ours still has thousands of treasures just waiting for you to discover. Hey everybody, Brian here, and I know you've heard that before. On behalf of myself, Richard, Nick, John, and Zach, the geography content team here at Mia Prep, I wanted to say that it's been a privilege and a pleasure to bring this course to you. It's our hope that you've gained a deeper understanding of and a rich appreciation for our planet and its many wonders. We also hope the skills we've practiced for taking a closer look at our world will help you think more critically and make better, more informed decisions moving forward. And remember this, wherever you travel in the days ahead, whether in your neighborhood or around the globe, be on the lookout for all the amazing things to discover about the natural world and the people within it. There's so much to cherish and protect. And as always, my friends, keep exploring. Hey, hey.